scripture reading this morning is Jeremiah 18, 1 through 11. It can be found in most pew Bibles on page 811. This is the word that came to Jeremiah from the Lord. Go down to the potter's house, and there I will give you my message. So I went down to the potter's house, and I saw him working at the wheel. But the pot he was shaping from the clay was marred in his hands, so the potter formed it into another pot, shaping it as seemed best to him. Then the word of the Lord came to me, O house of Israel, can I not do with you as this potter does? Declares the Lord, like clay in the hand of the potter, so are you in my hand, O house of Israel. If at any time I announce that a nation or kingdom is to be uprooted, torn down and destroyed, and if that nation I warn repents of its evil, then I will relent and not inflict on it the disaster I had planned. And if at another time I announce that a nation or kingdom is to be built up and planted, and if it does evil in my sight and does not obey me, then I will reconsider the good I had intended to do for it. Now therefore, say to the people of Judah and those living in Jerusalem, this is what the Lord says, look, I am preparing a disaster for you and devising a plan against you. So turn from your evil ways, each one of you, and reform your ways and your actions. The word of the Lord.
What a great song, huh? This morning, our gospel lesson comes from Luke 14, beginning with verse 25. Listen as Jesus speaks once again to the disciples as they hear a tough, tough lesson. Large crowds were traveling with Jesus, and turning to them, he said, if anyone comes to me and does not hate his father and mother, his wife and children, his brothers and sisters, yes, even his own life, he cannot be my disciple. And anyone who does not carry his cross and follow me cannot be my disciple. Suppose one of you wants to build a tower. Will he not first sit down and estimate the cost to see if he has enough money to complete it? For if he lays the foundation and is not able to finish it, everyone who sees it will ridicule him, saying, this fellow began to build and was not able to finish. Or suppose a king is about to go to war against another king. Will he not first sit down and consider whether he is able with 10,000 men to oppose the one coming against him with 20,000? If he is not able, he will send a delegation while the other is still a long way off and will ask terms of peace. In the same way, any of you who does not give up everything he has cannot be my disciple. May God bless us with the reading this morning of his word. Here Jesus is giving a tough lesson. Following me comes with a cost. And that's the same for us today. If we say we are Jesus' followers, we should know that it still costs us. Now, I first want to look back to our scripture because, you know, when you read it, I'm sure that everybody disagrees with it. Would you? Because it says, if anyone comes to me and does not hate his father and mother, his wife, his children, his brothers and sisters, yes, even his own life, he cannot be my disciple. What does Jesus teach us about hate?
Hate is bad.
So what is that saying? These are Jesus' words. These are the red words, folks. He says that we're supposed to hate our father and mother. Now, this is a challenge. Because in English, it says hate. But was the New Testament written in?
Aramaic.
It's Greek. So you know that this is one of the cases when there is a translation problem. Okay? It doesn't mean hate, 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 like we think of hate. It means that the family way should not be a priority. Okay? So what Jesus is saying is we have to give up our old ways, even those demands of our parents and our sisters and our brothers, and even our own wants and needs before we can follow Jesus and become his disciples. Now, does that make more sense?
Absolutely.
Okay. Just so we're on the same page. Now, the disciples who followed Jesus long ago sacrificed much to be one of his disciples. Think about it. When Jesus called the first disciples, they were what?
Fishermen.
Fishermen. And they dropped their nets and walked away and followed Jesus. They left their very livelihood, what they were living on, to follow Jesus. That's a sacrifice. It took them away from their careers, their known livelihood, into the unknown. And how many of us love walking into the unknown? Yep. Yet there was something about Jesus that made them want to do just that, to follow him without looking back. That took a lot of guts. It still takes a lot of guts to follow Jesus today. I think it would be easier for us today if there were a price tag attached. A tag that would clearly explain the extent of the cost. We're all consumers, so we could handle that. Because we comparison shop all the time, don't we? Anybody look to Acme and then ShopRite? Or ShopRite then Acme and maybe Aldi's? We're comparison shoppers in the world that we live in now. And that's just a small example. When was the last time you had to buy a car? You didn't just go to one place and say, I want that one. I'm sure you didn't. Maybe some of you did. Uh-oh, I'm in trouble. But we usually shop. When you were looking for a house, did you buy the first house you saw? You looked around. Before we buy anything, we look at the cost. Most of us, okay. Most of us look at the cost. And then we have a decision to make. Could I find it anywhere cheaper? Is this the best price around? We consider our need. Hopefully we consider our budget, if some of you work on budgets. And we consider our want and our need. If it's a huge purchase, we look to the finance agreement. Now, everybody look to that? See what the APR is, right? We see how much interest we're going to have to pay if we have to make payments on something. See if we can afford the terms or if it's beyond what we can realistically pay. If we buy it, can we continue in the same lifestyle we're accustomed to? Or do we need to sacrifice before we can make the purchase? Are there any hidden charges? Don't you love them? Do we have all the right information? When things are spelled out for us in black and white, we can make educated decisions. That is, if we're honest with ourselves. The problem is we sometimes are impulse consumers. And I know you're out there because you were shaking your heads before. It's great for the economy. Salesmen love you. If you ever felt unloved, they love you. But it's not great for us in the long run. When we make decisions, when we make that decision to follow Jesus, even though we have the entire Bible to use it as our guide, we all don't read it. And when we don't read it, when we don't understand everything that is part of that decision, we frequently become unhappy consumers. We don't become followers of Jesus like Jesus wants us to be. We become followers of convenience. Following him when it feels good, when we want something, when there is nothing worldly that interferes, then we'll follow Jesus. But that's not the right way to follow Jesus. Being a true follower, being a Christian, is costly. If you remember what Scripture tells us about the disciples, you will remember that they were followers until death. Once they were called by Jesus, they gave everything to follow him. It is true that they had a lot of moments when Jesus had to explain things over and over again, times when they truly didn't understand. Yet they continued to follow Jesus. We too, as Christians, will experience those same times when we're confused, when we question God, times when we grow frustrated. But my friends, it's those times when we need to stay the closest to our Lord, not to walk away because we don't understand. Once we make that commitment, we made a commitment to follow him. Being a faithful member of a family of believers does come with a cost. It's difficult because we can't just lay out some cash and say we've paid it all. It requires so much more that cannot be measured in dollars and cents. Sure, if we want to continue to have a place to worship, if we want to continue to minister to our community and to others, there's a financial cost, but that's not all. Becoming a follower of Jesus requires a change in behavior, a change in our attitude that, for the most part, the world does not understand. You see, to the world, being different is not a good thing. Nobody wants to be seen as being different. But to follow Jesus, we have to follow the scriptures and follow the commands that were given to believers long ago. It does take sacrifice. Sacrifice of time so that we can serve others. Sometimes it's time so we can help raise money and raise awareness. It takes saying no to some of the ways of the world and saying yes to Jesus. It is not easy for anything. Anytime you find yourself in the minority, you have to fight to be heard, to be respected, and to even be noticed. I think for others who have to pay their way into a church, those who are told how much they have to give, what days they have to show up, they respond because it's easier, because for them there's nothing hidden. But is that the truth? Even if we contribute each Sunday, if we attend Sunday school, Bible study, worship, is that all that is required of us? Even if we're baptized, or if we take communion every month, then we've met all the requirements, right? Hopefully you say no. If that's what you think, you've missed the mark. Becoming and living as a Christian has a cost that is never satisfied by just doing the minimum. The cost is ongoing, and it's a cost that can never be measured in dollars and cents. It's a lifestyle. It's a mindset. It's a total sacrifice measured by the example of none other than Jesus himself, the one and only Son of God. So this is the time when we say yes, despite what's in our bank accounts. God wants all of us, every part of us, and it is a sacrifice, but it is one that will never be able to, that we will never be able to live without. Knowing Jesus and being his disciple has a cost, but it's a cost that we all should be willing to pay. Amen. Amen. It is a good thing that to follow Jesus, we don't have to have a certain credit score. It's not about what's in our bank accounts, but it's what's in our heart that counts. When we surrender our lives to Jesus and give him our all, he will take what we have and use it so that his kingdom can grow here on earth. There is a cost, my friends, but we can all afford it. Let us follow Jesus without worrying about the cost. Amen.